Okay, so I'll be presenting on my master's work, Population Status, the White Shark in Mossel Bay. So, as you guys mostly know from Meza's talk, white sharks have a circum-global distribution, and a lot of them concentrate in the temperate regions of the world. So Africa is internationally recognized as a center of abundance for white sharks, and there's a lot of research that is going on. However, despite this, limited information is available on the demographics of the species. So if you look over here, this is where most of the research is occurring. And despite this, only a lot of the published information has come from the Natal Sharks Board regarding population, demographics, and status. So research that the Natal Sharks Board has done is they published their data set from 1978 to 2003, which is one of the longest data sets in South Africa. They found that white sharks have a stable population trend based on catches in the Natal Sharks Board nets. However, they did find a declining trend in the mean average size of white shark females, and the largest size was 3.5 meters, and just to give an idea, most white shark females become sexually mature around 4 to 4.5 meters, so the fact that the size is declining could mean one or two things. Maybe large individuals aren't moving up there anymore, or they're not utilizing that area as much, or possibly the white sharks, females, or just in general white sharks, aren't growing to as large a size as they had previously. Okay, so the main aims of my master's was to look at the spatial and seasonal variation for white sharks, utilizing Mossel Bay, and then also to come up with an index of abundance for Mossel Bay white shark. So this is the study sites in Mossel Bay that we had. Seal Island, which is characterized by a cape for a seal colony. It's really small, about 5,000 seals, so not as amazing as you have further down the coast. Then Hartenbos, which is characterized by a reef system as well as an estuary. Claim Rock has a permanently open estuary and is also characterized by a reef system. And then the area that we saw called Rock is largely characterized by a reef system, although there is an estuary over here which don't really sample over there, of course, in this general region. Data collection, we attract the sharks using chum, which is sort of standard practice, and then we use bait, tuna heads or dorada heads, bait to manipulate the shark's behavior and to try and get them to fin and bring them closer to the boat so we can photograph their dorsal fins. We looked at estimated size. We used a pole of known length, which we put on the side of the boat, and estimated the size as the shark swam by. But recently we've upgraded this to use paired laser photogrammetry to improve our size estimates. And then I used a multi-feature approach to identify individuals in the population based on their dorsal fins. So looking at a combination of black pigmentation, white pigmentation, notch structure in addition to sex and estimated size, as well as if present, amputations or fin deformities, and then scarring depending on how bad the scarring was, because obviously they lost for different amounts of time. Okay, so for the relative abundance, the data that I used was from 717 sample trips. Observation effort was 1,758 hours and 20 minutes. The mean effort, the mean length of time for a charm trip was 2 hours and 49 minutes. The amount of white shark sightings that we had across the time period that we sampled was 2,648, and we had a mean of 1.3 sharks sighted per hour. This is just the seasonal patterns. There was no significant difference between the different seasons that we sampled in. So summer and autumn are pretty much similar. It spikes up in winter, and I think that this is linked to more individuals coming into the bay, most likely transient individuals taking advantage of the seal colony. And then spring was actually lower than summer, which I hadn't expected. Spring, you'll see later in the slideshow, coincides with the highest abundance or highest density of larger individuals of over 3 meters, and that might be with so many large individuals, then the sharks might be more spaced out, as well as what I've noticed when you have smaller sharks around the boat and a bigger shark comes by around 3 meters, 3.5 meters, then the other sharks disperse, so that might be a reason why we're seeing a lower site climate for that. Then for spatial patterns, Seal Island and Hutmores are similar. It spikes up at Plain Rock and then goes down a little at Hurd Rock. So Seal Island is the hunting grounds for the white shark, and Hutmores is considered a resting area in between when they forage and that. So that's why I think those two are similar. Plain Rock was an open estuary, so is likely more productive in terms of fish biomass than Hurd Rock, and because Hurd Rock also has a lot of fish biomass, that's why it's slightly higher than these areas. Also, again, later in the slideshow, around 80% of the individuals in Mossel Bay are between 2 and 3 meters, so they're not yet foraging on marine mammals. So I think that's why these areas are higher than Sea Island. Okay, then for the size composition, we grouped the cohorts based on size class. So group 1 is 1.2 to 1.7 meters total length, then group 2 was 1.7 to 3.2, and then group 3 was 3.2 to the 75.2 meters total length. So sampling trips were 481 sampling trips we utilized for this. Analyses, white shark sightings were 1,508, and we had individuals across all size classes that we sampled during that time. Okay, seasonal patterns and size composition. Summer and autumn were both dominated by the first size class, so 1.2 to 1.7, so on 2 meters in size. Then winter, we had predominance of about 2 to 3 meter size class. And we think that because 80% of the individuals in this area are fall in that size class, that Mossel Bay could form a sort of training ground area. So where they're learning how to hunt the Cape fur seals, also winter coincides with the time when the Cape fur seals pups a forage offshore for the first time, making them slightly easier targets. And then spring, as I mentioned earlier, coincides with predominance, just over 50% of the larger size classes, so 3 to 3.5 meters and larger. I'm not entirely sure. I think that might have some linkage to artificial reproduction, something like that. Then the spatial patterns, you'll see Seal Island has equal percentage of the larger size classes, so 3 meters and larger, and then as well as the one just before that, so 2 to 3 meters. This makes sense if the 2 to 3 meter class is training and learning how to hunt paper seals, and then this class obviously would be exploiting that particular resource. Hutmores and Claybrook, you can link together. They're both with the 3 meters and higher size classes. As I said before, Hutmores is considered a resting area in between when white sharks are hunting at Seal Island, and it may be that Claybrook is an additional or extended resting area, so they actually could be going further, not only just stopping in Hutmores, but maybe also going further to Claybrook as well, and resting there and then patrolling along the coast back to Seal Island. And then photograph was dominated by the smaller size class, so under 2 meters. This makes sense because obviously this is, has a high fish biomass, and if you look at these areas that are dominated by the larger size classes, 3 meters and higher, the size segregation would imply that these ones are trying to defer or stay away from the larger size classes. Okay. Then for the population estimate, I used a jellic zebra model, specifically POPAN in the program MARC. For those that might know the program, I identified 261 unique individuals using the multi-feature approach based on dorsal fin ID. This is just a breakdown of how the model works and what I use. So N1, N2, and N3, you could look at as your sampling occasions, so each year, for example. Then you can, it puts out different constraints, and or you can constrain different parameters. So you have immigration, or the probability of new individuals entering the population. You have survival between the different sampling occasions. And then lastly, you have capturability, the likelihood of you actually photographing and identifying that individual in the population. So that's the PROPAN model. From this, in 2008, we identified 136 unique individuals. In 2009, we identified 65 new individuals. And then in 2010, we identified 60 new individuals. Then 25 of these total individuals were seen in all 3 years. And then these were just the number of individuals that were cited specifically for each year. Then the population estimate that I got using this POPAN model was 389 white sharks with confidence intervals of 351 to 428 individuals. So this number just represents an index of abundance. We don't really have anything that we can compare it to. So just look at it as a baseline estimate, and this indicates the amount of sharks that we utilize in Mossel Bay throughout the course of the study area, which a study period which was 2008 to 2010. Then I just went on a course at the beginning of April, which looked at estimating animal abundance and occupancy, and one of the programs that we specifically dealt with was Program Mark. The guy that created Program Mark, Dr. Gary White, was there, and I showed him my stuff because my paper had initially got rejected and ripped to shreds. So I asked him, you know, what did I do wrong? Am I doing the right thing? And he said that although it is an open population, which the COPAN model accounts for, what it doesn't account for is the number of individuals that were not successfully identified. And so that was a major violation on my part. So I've been working with him to get insight into which model to better use. So I'll probably use a different model before I publish this information. And then some of you guys might know, but there's a lot that might not know. I'm also looking at combining the photo ID data sets from the different areas in South Africa for white sharks, so False Bay, Hans Bay, Eldorado Bay, and Mossel Bay. And initially I was thinking of using this potential model, not this one, but the potential model that I discussed with Gary White to model the national population and get an idea of just a baseline index of abundance. However, I'm not sure if that model can deal with the complexities involved with modeling it at the national level, as well as the different issues that might arise from using data sets from different areas, as well as across different years, and not always being able to identify the individuals, even though you have a photograph. So the main conclusions for this, spring has the lowest relative abundance, catch-period effort, and it coincides with a larger subset of white sharks that we find in Mossel Bay. Again, I think that this is because with the large individuals, they tend to be more spaced out, and that's why we have a lower time period effort for that. that. Winter has the highest relative abundance, and this is likely because it attracts a lot of transient individuals into the area, which are taking advantage of seals during that time. Overall, I mentioned this just in general, we have a predominance of the 2 to 3 meter size class, which makes about 80% of our population in Mossel Bay. And then the abundance estimate that I got, or baseline estimate, we don't really have anything to compare to. Hopefully the others will be, the other guys in Australia, Bobe and Hans Bay are working on the estimates so we can look at how it all fits together, but this pretty much represents a subset of the greater southern African metapopulation of white sharks. Mm-hmm.